At this point, Mrs. Hall, can you do the invocation? A moment of silence, please.
Please rise. We've had some tragic events, and now we have a new year. But I'm told that we continue to have tragic events, unfortunately. My hope is for all of us that we have a brighter year than our last few months. Please, moment of silence in respect to those people we've lost. And Mr. Chair would like to clarify my last statement.
As Mrs. Hall said, we've lost some folks here, and it's very, very sad. But in our own community, we lost a young person on Sunday, Aileen Ferron. She's a 16-year-old sophomore at Enfield High School. She died after a long illness, and we'd ask that you add an additional moment of silence and prayer for her family and her fellow students.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The fire evacuation announcement. In case the alarm goes off and we have to evacuate the council chamber, there are two exits. One immediately in front of me to your rear, go through the double doors and out onto the lawn. Or to my left, your right, go through those double doors and down the stairs outside into the parking lot. Before we do the roll call, I'd just like to welcome our newly appointed member and welcome him back, Tom Sherrard. Thank you very much. We're very, very happy to have you and your experience here with us tonight. Thank you. Kathy, roll call, please.
Ms. Hall? Mrs.
Rancourt? Here.
Mr. Janitis?
Here.
Mrs. LeBlanc?
Here.
Mr. Feely?
Here.
Mr. Grady?
Here.
Mrs. Suzak?
Here.
Mr. Sherrard?
Here.
Chairman Neville?
Here. We have no board guests, I believe, and we'll turn it over for item 7 to Dr. Schumann.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There are five items in the superintendent's report. The first is the Joint Security Committee. The Joint Security Committee has been formed and is planning to meet weekly and discuss safety and security in our schools. A group of members from the committee, along with some other members from our schools, did attend the security conference on Monday at the AquaTurf with over 800 other members of law enforcement and school systems and politicians from around the state, and we'll have a report on that tomorrow when we meet, and that committee will continue to meet until their work is finished. In your packet, you have some information on the Parent Leadership Academy. We thank the folks involved for their dedication in getting that together and helping our parents with a hand up and learning some valuable skills. The Superintendent's Book Club, the second meeting of the book club will be held tomorrow. The first one was held on December 12th. We're looking into the book Drive, The Surprising Truth About What Motivates Us. And tomorrow we'll look at two of the middle chapters, and that group will meet again on February 13th. The board has two special meetings planned this Saturday at 8 o'clock. The board will be meeting, and their meeting will be facilitated by Mr. Robert Rader. He is the Executive Director of the Connecticut Association of Boards of Education. Mr. Rader is going to come and work with the board as they work to set their priorities going into the budget season. And then next Tuesday will be a special meeting. Excuse me. And the board will be looking at another phase of the budget through one of its goals. And so we'll get into that in a little more in the presentation. And just to inform everyone that on January 21st, it'll be Martin Luther King Jr. Day, the schools in Enfield will be closed.
Very good. Item 8, audiences. Is there anybody that would like to speak to the board? Anybody signed up?
No.
Seeing none, then we'll move on to item 9, unfinished business. There is none, I believe, correct? And then item 10, new business. Dr. Schumann, you ready to present your draft budget at this point in time?
I am. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Very good. We've asked the superintendent to put together over the last few months, or weeks anyway, a draft budget itemizing the needs of the district and keeping in tune with the goals that the board has adopted. So I believe he's been working hard, at least I've heard from all of the administrators and department chairs, that they've been working hard with him to get this budget together. So we'll turn the podium over to you.
Dr. Schuman? Dr. Schuman?
Yes.
Could I just have 30 seconds?
Certainly.
Last night I came to the council meeting. There was a wee bit of talk about a certain football team winning the national championship. Well, it didn't happen. And you'll notice the colors.
Go Tide.
Okay.
Thank you, Peter. Never one to rub it in.
Technology looks like it's up. I want to thank the board for an opportunity to present a needs budget on behalf of the students of Enfield and welcome some of our guests. We have some members from our town council here with us tonight. It's great to have you here, and our town manager, and certainly all of our administrators and members of the cabinet. Tonight we're going to take a look at...
I just turned it on. Sorry.
Okay. Now everyone can hear us out and abroad. We also want to thank the and welcome the folks who are watching on ETV and those members of the council who may not have been able to make it tonight who might be watching us. The Enfield Public Schools is a mission-based school system, and our mission is to enable all students to meet high standards, make productive choices in their personal lives, and contribute to a diverse and global society and act as responsible citizens. We believe that every student should be college and career ready when they leave the Enfield Public Schools. It's not an either or. They have to be college and career ready when they get ready to leave us. So in preparing the budget, the superintendent has some responsibilities. First one is to prepare a recommended plan for the board to consider. In order to do that, we start with the board priorities. Have to seek input from stakeholders. Now, over the course of the fall, we went out and did 16 or 17 listen and learn sessions. We listened to members of the community, we listened to parents, we listened to teachers, we listened to students. We heard all the things they told us, and we know what they'd like to have us be able to accomplish in our schools. We rolled all that into our budget request. And then our job is to prepare a budget that meets the needs of the community. When we do this, we have lots of things to consider. First thing we need to consider is the board priorities and the district goals. Then we look at the school improvement plans. Our administrators have worked very hard with their staffs to identify the areas that they want to focus on and concentrate to make their schools better places. And we certainly listen to the students and the teachers and the parents of our community. And then we have to take into account the state mandates. The things that we have to do and the things that we must participate in, the mandates and the school reforms. So preparing the budget is a challenging, and it's also a rewarding process. Looking at our accomplishments, the things that we've been able to get done, is very rewarding. We also know there's lots of challenges that lie ahead for us. I'm going to start by looking at the accomplishments. We worked with our administrative staff. We talked about the things that we've been able to accomplish over the last year here in Enfield. So we'll look at it in four levels: elementary, middle, high school, and then from a district perspective. From an elementary perspective, 9% increase in CMT reading from 2008 to 2012. A 10% increase in math from 2008 to 2012. Our CMT scores are in the upper 25% of our DERG. We provide academic interventions through tiered instruction. We take large group. If students are struggling, we break them into smaller groups. If students are still struggling, we break them into more smaller and in more focused groups. We've established 90-minute blocks for our English language learners. We've increased emphasis on reading comprehension using complex text. Our class sizes in Enfield are below the state average. A lot of that has to do with the reconfiguration of the schools that the board went through a couple years ago. As the pictures show you, we celebrate our Reads Across America, the program, for the second year this year, something that very few communities have had the opportunity to say they were able to do. At the middle level, our CMT scores exceed the state average. We have character education programs like Patriot Pride and our Citizenships Award, and this fall, the joint effort between the town board, the town council, and the board to bring Rachel's Challenge to Enfield. And we have the grade 6 accelerated math program. We also had the Leaders for the Future program that's ongoing, where the students spend 2 days learning about leadership projects, and the mayor and the board chair both sat in and participated in that, along with members from LEGO and MassMutual. Those projects are ongoing, and we're going to see in 5 or 6 weeks how well they are able to move the culture and climate ahead at JFK Middle School. The board reinstated interscholastic athletics, and those teams have been highly successful. Lots of our students have been able to participate in those so far this year. And the middle schools here have been accredited since 1988. So certainly a long run, over 30 years of accreditation, which shows that we are a peer-reviewed school system, that we're willing to open our doors to other folks and let them come in and help us be successful. The sixth grade was successfully integrated last year and now is running as a sixth, seventh, and eighth grade middle school. This year we've started a gifted and talented program. It started out small with a group of students, and they're working on their Type 3 projects, and we'll be looking to see how those projects are coming along as they move further into the year. And we're increasing the rigor and challenge of academic courses by reducing the number of levels, further implementing our vision that all students can learn at high levels. At the high school, we're offering college-level courses through our partnership with Nuntuck, the Early College Placement Program with UConn, and our Advanced Placement Program. And our high schools have been credited. Enfield High School since 1946, and Fermi High School since its inception in 1970. It shows a level of commitment to high-quality education that the Enfield Public Schools has shown over the years. We have a domestic violence contest winner amongst our high school students. We have strong athletic programs. We have various extended learning opportunities so our students can learn outside of the classroom, after school, various clubs and other types of activities. District-wide, we have the Rachel's Challenge program, which has affected all of our schools and have been out into the community as well. We have an enhanced data network allowing us to track the progress of our students. We began an iPad consortium where 300 iPads were distributed and being used out in the classroom with students at various levels in various ways. And we're learning from those uses as to how we can utilize this technology better in the future. We've set up our Teacher Access Center, our Home Access Center for grades 3 through 12. We've partnered with Nuntuck on the Career College Pathways courses. And we've established a partnership with LEGO that will bring creativity and innovation centers to 7 of our schools beginning next fall, in grades kindergarten 2 and 4 next year, and the following year in grades 1, 3, and 5. We've had author visits in 6 of our K-5 libraries. We've offered 3 sections of Introduction to Engineering, getting ready for our STEAM wing of our new high school. We put in place a rapid notification system called School Messenger, and it's been highly successful at getting a lot of good information out to our community. And currently we have over 250 people following the Enfield Public Schools on our Twitter account, getting information from us that way. Now we certainly have our challenges ahead of us. Our accomplishments are great. We look forward and they're rewarding for us to look at, but we have a lot of challenges. One of them is implementing state mandates without additional funding. And you see the word SEED there. SEED is the new evaluation program that's coming to us. We're going to be mandated to put a new state evaluation plan in place. It's part of the state's waiver from No Child Left Behind. When the state agreed and the federal government agreed to give us the waiver from No Child Left Behind, they said we had to implement a brand new evaluation system, and that comes with a lot of attached resources, and there won't be a lot of funding to go with it. We're participating in school reform, the Common Core State Standards, taking up a lot of our time as we rewrite our curriculum to make it more efficient and deliver a better education to our children. And we're also looking at high school reform. So we have the challenge of overcoming significant reductions while maintaining programs and services. And this has been a challenge that's faced all communities for the last 4 or 5 years as the budgets have been getting tighter and the dollars have been getting shorter. So we are not without challenges. They come at us At the same time, our work is changing drastically. The things that we need to do in our schools has changed. What you see here is a clip from the Hartford Courant from around 1961, the year I began kindergarten. My mother cut this out of the paper and preserved it with Scotch tape. And it kind of depicts what our schools are about, at least what they were about in 1961. It said, school bulletin board, free, every Monday through Friday. Knowledge, bring your own container. And what that captured was the schools were there, and you needed to show up, and you took the opportunity that they gave you to learn, and then you turned around and left. It was presented to you, you took what you needed, you brought your own container, and you left. And those rules have changed. We can't do that anymore. We have a much higher standard. We have higher responsibilities. Today, every student must show academic growth. Simply providing the opportunity for them to learn is not good enough. We have to ensure that they do learn and that they learn at high levels. And every student must attain math and science skills. And every student must have 21st century skills to compete in a global marketplace. These are givens. We have to make sure that we accomplish these things. Simply providing an opportunity and opening the doors every morning is not good enough. We have a responsibility to ensure that our students learn. So the critical thinking skills, the things that we have to ensure that they leave us with, they have to be able to think critically, solve problems. They have to have innovation skills, have to understand creativity, have to be self-directed learners, have to have strong work ethic, have to know how to collaborate with others. They certainly need to know how to communicate in writing. They need to know how to use this technology that keeps changing before us, and they need to have leadership skills. Most of us are pretty much used to the type of instruction you see down below. Sit and get type information. It was presented to us, we took it. We don't need that anymore. There's an app for that. All those things that we can do on a blackboard, they can do on an iPad through technology, it's those skills up on top that we have to find a way to integrate into our school system. Our students have got a different type of world. They need to connect to each other. They need to connect to their teachers. And they need to connect to a global society. So we do have some challenges. We have some critical challenges. One is we need to meet the needs of all students, not some, all students. And we have to do that with the limited economic resources we have in front of us. So we have to build a budget that balances the needs of every one of our students with the needs of our community. And that is and are the two critical challenges that we face as we put together a spending plan to recommend to you this evening. So how are we going to present this? We're going to talk a little bit about the budget process, talk about what we went through to get there. We'll talk about the components of the budget, what's included in it. We'll present some other helpful data that will help you understand the budget in perspective. And we'll leave you with some conclusions and some beliefs that we have about what we can accomplish. So the process starts with the Board of Education. Board of Education establishes goals and priorities. And tonight, as Chairman Ebel did, we want to welcome Mr. Sherrard back as he's joined us. And we've been superimposed him into the board. And not to demean the work of Mr. Johnson, who had to leave for personal reasons, but we're glad to have a full board moving forward into this process as we take on this work. About a year ago, the board met, a year ago yesterday, and they worked on establishing their priorities, the things that were important to them. And they'll continue that work and refocus this Saturday. The things that were important to them were initiating a curriculum upgrade to reflect the Common Core. They wanted to monitor the K-8 reorganization. They wanted to develop, implement a high school consolidation process. They wanted to create a plan for full-day kindergarten. We want to develop, use, analyze data to expand the capacity for data-driven decision-making. We wanted to fully integrate technology plan with professional development. We wanted to engage in undertaking information and advocacy initiatives with the town council. And they wanted to expand opportunities for sports at the middle school. And so from those priorities, the district developed six goals. The first one was to develop a rigorous core curriculum, implement highly effective research-based instructional strategies, and make instructional decisions based on close analysis of student performance data. They wanted to ensure the high school consolidation initiative supports the needs of the community by creating a 21st century education facility. They wanted to embark on a quest to identify the best strategy or strategies for the implementation of full-day kindergarten program in the Enfield Public Schools. To research, design, and implement an integrated solution for collecting, warehousing, and analyzing student performance data. To recommend a new educator evaluation system for adoption by the Board of Education, which meets the state mandates that's coming to us. And to promote, develop, implement, and sustain various collaborative initiatives and shared services in targeted areas with town government and community partners. The budget proposal you're going to look at this evening will allow us to meet almost all of the board priorities in a very formal and significant way. And it will advance the work of all six of the district goals. The process used to develop the budget began with the Board of Education, giving us the direction through its priorities and its goals, and then we take it back to the classroom. And the teachers in the district were asked to help us identify what the needs were. They're working with our students every day. They know firsthand what it takes to advance their learning. So we started there. Their requests were reviewed by the principals and department chairs. And each principal and department chair came and met with the cabinet. And we sat for a couple of days and went through all of the requests in detail. And the cabinet reviewed the budget and made a recommendation to me. And then I began to make some decisions about what I thought would balance the needs of our students along with meeting the needs of our community. So the budget components are relatively simple. We are a people-driven operation. We have students that we service, and we service them with the talents of our adults. So we have a salary side, what it costs for us to put talented adults in the classrooms and in our offices so that we're able to meet the needs of our students. And we have a non-salary side, all the things we need to do that. And if we're only this simple, we take both sides, we put them together, and we would have our budget. We're going to take a look in detail at what the salary side entails and what's on the non-salary side. So when we asked our staff, what do we need? This is what they told us. They came to us and they said, we're requesting on the salary side, $46 million worth of people. On the non-salary side, $25 million worth of supplies. And a total budget of almost $72 million. We compare that to what we started with this year. It's significantly more. And we look at the difference. It's an $8.7 million increase over the current spending package. Salaries increase 6.2%. Non-salary, the things part of our budget, increases 30.7%, for a total budget increase of 13.9%. So, Mr. Chairman, I'm done. All you need to do is cut the check and we're good to go. Now, that's where our work really starts. You know, we could bring our administrators who are here and our teachers up to you, and we did meet with them. And they made a compelling argument for that 13.9%. You know, there's nothing there that I would tell you we don't need. And as I told the administrators before we came over, unfortunately, I can't tell the community that we can get everything we need. We know that there has to be some kind of a middle ground, a balancing act. So this is where we started to do our work. So how do we figure out if our need is 13.9% and we need to get it to a number that allows the community to be able to fund this? Well, first we'll take a look at the salary requests. The salary requests are going up 6.2%. Our existing costs are $44,210,475. We are obligated to our bargaining units and contractual agreements that we've made to keep our existing staff in place. That's what that would cost. The new positions that were requested are $1.8 million. Gives us our increase of $2.6 million over last year, or the salary side of our budget goes up 6%. There were 37.4 new positions requested in the budget. We had requests for classroom and support teachers. We had requests for special education teachers, speech teachers, English language learner, occupational therapists, physical therapists. We had requests for assistant principals at our elementary schools, intervention specialists, social workers, psychologists, instructional coaches, and counselors. Requests for more athletic coaches. We have requests for clerical and technological support personnel. So we had to really start to think. 37 positions, 6.2%. How do we make the decision about what's the most important thing? What are our greatest needs? What do we need the most? For this, we return to our goals. Return to our theory of actions on goal one. If the MPL Public Schools adopts a rigorous curriculum and provides effective professional development opportunities for teachers to enhance their instructional practice, then students will improve and the student achievement will improve and students will be prepared for college and career success. And we looked at our theory of action for goal three. The MPL Public Schools affords all students with a full-day kindergarten program, then student achievement will improve and our learners will become better prepared for their academic careers. And goal five, if educators are evaluated using a system that will increase their capacity to provide effective instruction, then students will learn and achieve at high levels. And a board priority to expand sports opportunities at the middle school. After thinking hard about those theories and the requests, I've decided to move some of the positions forward. We're going to move forward three classroom teachers to implement a full-day kindergarten for all students in Enfield. We're going to move forward seven elementary assistant principals to strengthen instruction, build capacity of our teaching staff, and meet the requirements of SEED, the state mandate on educator evaluation. We're going to move forward three middle school coaches so we can offer volleyball and boys and girls track at JFK Middle School. We're going to move forward 1.5 full-time equivalent secretaries so we can take our 10-month secretaries and make them 12-month secretaries. And this way we'll have their skill and talent all summer long, but most importantly, we will have someone to man the doors at every one of our schools. Right now, we don't have anybody there for the summer. And with the security needs that we feel we need to have someone monitoring those cameras and giving access to the correct people during the summer as well as during the school year. Right now, our buildings are wide open in the summer. People come and go. We feel we need to tighten that up. So what does that do to the requests? Staff costs. With the 14.4 additional positions is $45 million. Last year's staff cost was 43. The difference is 1.7 million. Salary side of the budget is going up 4.02%. The total impact on the budget is 2.76%. So we're asking the board to consider an increase in the total budget of 2.76% for the salary side of the budget. The other side of the budget was the non-salary areas. All of these other areas, the things, so to speak, that we need to do the work in our schools that our students deserve. What's included? Computers, textbooks, workbooks, supplies, and some other things like technological infrastructure, general insurance, contract services, and materials needed to operate the buildings. We had a request of $25.8 million to do those things. Last year that cost 19.7. The increase was $6 million. So the non-salary side of the budget, the request totaled 30.8%. So we need to eliminate some of the things we can do without. And we need to find creative ways to substitute for the things that we can't afford. So we'll start to look at these a little bit closer, as you can see what's impacting the non-salary side. our benefits. 2012 was $10.4 million. Request was just over 11. My recommendation is to fund that at 10.6 or a 1.85% increase in the benefit portion of the budget. Instructional supplies and professional development. It was funded this year at $564,000. Request came in at almost $2.3 million. I'm proposing $786,000, an increase of almost 40%. What's in that 40%? Well, there's 200 iPads for an iPad 2 consortium. There is money to establish an online professional development system for our teachers. There's a new reading program, there's a new writing program, and there's a data warehouse. Our legal services are going up 2%, our copier contract is going up 2%. Our legal services, we're budgeting another $23,000 because we're going into a negotiation session that we know could be lengthy and probably could go a full duration. We're reducing our supply items for repairs and maintenance 1.33%. Our pupil transportation costs are going up 0.79%. Reducing our postage 23.6%. A lot of this is due to the fact that we now have school messenger. Instead of sending things home in paper, we're going to be able to use our systems. We can take $10,000 out of that account. Ads for employment. We're going to find more creative ways to advertise online. We've taken $5,000 out of that. Our printing costs are also going to go down, so we're not going to need to distribute as much material. Hopefully we can do it through online services. Taking 8.6% out of our general supplies, taking 5.46% out of our office supplies. Our special education costs, which we'll look at in more detail, are going up 37.6%. So the recommendation here for non-salary costs is $21.8 million. Last year was $19.7 million. And the change, the difference is $2 million. And the overall change on the non-salary side of the budget is 10.3%. So we break this down on the budget impact. Our information technology responsibilities are causing the budget to increase by 1.56%. We all know this portion of the budget was funded last year in part with one-time dollars to bring down the cost. This year the board will be responsible for fully funding the entire cost of the information technology program, and that will make an impact on the total budget to make sure the full all the funds come out of the board's budget of 1.56%. Special education will push the budget up, the entire budget up 1.06%. Instructional supplies and professional development will move the budget up another 0.35%. The cost to provide the benefits that we are obligated to provide will cost the board 3.1%. All of the other areas combined will add 0.18% to the budget. One of the things we're asking the board to consider is to petition the town council to enact the provision that allows the board to carry over 1% of its budget. The board can carry over up to 1% of its budget with the approval of the town council and utilize that for next year. So the board could carry over approximately $630,000 if you were to carry over 1%. Our projections don't show that we're going to have 1% at the end of the school year. But we do feel relatively comfortable saying to you, we think you may have a quarter of a percent left over, approximately $150,000 that will be left over at the end of the year that we could comfortably say to you, it would be worth asking the town council to consider letting you roll over $150,000 to help you get started with next year's budget. So these are the areas on the non-salary side that are going to drive the budget up, and we'll look at them in more detail shortly. But first I want to revisit our discussion on special education. Special education is a side of our budget that was going up quite a bit. Approximately 14% of our students in our school district meet the federal guidelines and qualify as students with special needs. And we are required to provide, not only to all students, but to every student, an education that is appropriate for them. And some students, that education costs more money because of their special needs. Sometimes they require additional staffing materials to meet their needs, and sometimes they have greater needs and must be placed in other facilities outside of what we can provide for. Our department, our special education department, does a fantastic job of providing for the students as best they can with the resources we have, and it's a balancing act. Do we buy more things and establish more programs here in Enfield, or do we ask our families to locate their students in other facilities that specialize in the needs that their students need? But what we are finding is the tuition costs are going up, and the state, which was reimbursing us at one level, continues to pull back on their reimbursement. So we're finding the costs going up and our dollars coming back from the state to help us on this area going down. So when we look at the special education side, we're estimating about $2.4 million to meet the needs of our special education students next year. And this year that cost was $1.7 million. We expect that difference to be about $667,000. So that is going up 37% in special education, and the impact on the total budget is about 1%, just over 1%, 1.06%. So if we do a review of the total dollars, what does it all look like rolled together? We asked our staff to tell us what they needed. This is where we began. They came to us and they said, we need $71.9 million to operate this school with all of the things we need to do the jobs we want to do. Through my work, I've reduced $5 million from that. So I'm asking the board to consider a budget of $66,918,094. What does that summary break down to? We need $987,000, or 1.56%, to meet our side of the obligation to fund the IT department. We have existing salary obligations, things that we're contractedly obligated to do. We need $860,000 to do that, 1.36%. I propose some new positions to you. The cost of those new positions is $884,000, or 1.4% of our total budget. Our special education increase is $667,000, or 1.06%. The cost to provide the benefits we're obligated to provide is 0.31%, or $193,000. Our instructional supplies and professional development is $222,000, or 0.35% of the budget. All of the other things rolled together, another $110,000, or 0.18%. The request to carry over some of the funds for next year, if the town council approves, would reduce us by 0.24. And the overall budget request then would be for $3.7 million, or a 5.98% increase over the current spending plan. Some of the other helpful data that will help you put all this into perspective, at least we hope it will. Our class size comparisons to the state, some of the previous budget increases, per pupil expenditure data. We take a look at our class sizes. Here in Enfield, we do exceptionally well compared to the state. When you see the numbers in green, that means our class sizes are below the state average. That shows the commitment that the town has made to providing good learning environments for its students. The state data is not available for 11-12 or 12-13, but we feel we're going to stay below the state average, so we put it in green. At grade 2, for many years we've been below the state average or right next to it. It was just one blip there where we went a little bit above. Again, we've made a commitment to early childhood education here. We've made a commitment to primary education. In fifth grade, class sizes are creeping up. They're getting a little bit bigger. We don't feel comfortable putting those last 2 years in green. If you look at where the state's been pretty much on average, and our numbers have gone up a little bit. And when you get to the secondary level, there's some interesting calculations that get done in the way they figure out class sizes. And what we understand, the state's having a little trouble getting those calculations together. So we haven't received the data back. So we only have data up to 2010-11. But again, here, and we all know that when we created the largest, one of the largest middle schools in the state, we did force the class sizes up a little bit. And our high school numbers, again, not off the charts, but it'll slightly above state average as we go through and take a look at them. Look at the things that the numbers, the amount requested by the Board of Education over the previous years. And it's fluctuated. But it certainly, over the last 4 years, has shown that the board has been cognizant of the economic times and made respectable requests. Over what comes with making very low requests and being aware of that is the need at some point to think about replenishing some of the things that we have not purchased over the years. And so I am asking the board to consider a request of 5.98%. If we look at our per pupil expenditures compared to the state, we only have this data up to 2010 right now. Enfield has done exceptionally well and has not been funding at a per pupil level the same as the state has. Some of our conclusions. The budget recognizes the desire of the community to maintain a high-quality school system. We heard that loud and clear when we went out and met with people in the community. We also heard that you have to work within limited economic resources. But we know that families make decisions on where to relocate. We also know they make decisions these days on where to send their children to school. They have more choices besides public education. So the quality and the reputation of the school system becoming more and more important if we want to keep our students here in school in Enfield. The budget impacts the entire community, we understand that. But it also has a lasting effect for the years into the future. The school system's belief directly reflect the beliefs of the community. People think the school systems are important places, and they are. And they make decisions about where they want to live because of the way the school systems are run. Go back one more time and look at where the increases in the current budget are coming from. In order to get to the proposal of 5.98%, we start with our current funding plan. We know existing salaries drive the budget up 1.36%. The new positions move the budget up 1.4%. Our commitment to fully fund the Information Technology Department moves the budget up 1.56%. Our commitment to our special education students moves the budget up 1.06%. The benefits, 0.31. Professional development, instructional supplies, 0.35. All the other areas combined, 0.18. And we know that we're looking to reduce the budget by 0.25%, possibly through carrying over of $150,000. So if we were to do that, what would we gain? We would maintain our current staffing and our programming. We wouldn't lose anything. We would provide full-day kindergarten for every student in Enfield. We would have a second iPad consortium with 200 new iPads to put into the hands of our students. We'd add 3 new sports teams at JFK Middle School. We'd put a new writing program in, grades K through 6. Put a new reading program in grades 2 through 8. We would access something called e-reader, which would allow us to access 1,800 literature titles through the iPads that we have and other computer devices, other online devices. We'd establish a data warehousing system that would help us track student performance data, make better decisions about the individual needs of our children. We would provide opportunities for our students to experience the online testing environment. All the CMTs and CAP tests are going to be given online in just a couple years. We've built in a system that will allow grades 4, 7, and 10 next year to be able to utilize that system and experiment with it and get training in it so that those students are ready, and we'd expand that over the next couple years. So by the time we hit it and it counted for real, our students would have the experience of how that works. we'd be able to develop an online professional laboratory for our teachers to participate in. We'd enhance our leadership and security through new administrative positions and new clerical positions. We'd increase our internet bandwidth from 100 megabytes to 300 megabytes. It would allow for all the new devices we want to put in place. So where do we go next? Well, the Board of Education will be asked to review the plan that you've just seen. And you'll be reviewing that plan starting on Saturday morning as you talk about your priorities, what you've heard tonight, what's most important to you. And then we'll be presenting in more detail the parts of this budget. We'll present it to you through the goals. We'll take one goal at the meeting next Tuesday night, and we'll start with our goal for putting in a full-day kindergarten. And we'll tell you how we're going to implement that plan. We'll tell you why it's important, and we'll tell you what the funding is going to be in order to do that. And we'll take the goals one at a time. We'll present all that information to you so you have that, and you can think about that, and you can match it up with your own priorities in terms of what you feel you want to accomplish in this budget. And at some point down the road, you're going to be asked to adopt the budget and pick a number and move it on to the town council. And we have many of our town councilors here. We'll turn it over to their trustworthy hands, and we'll ask them to think about that in a broader sense, a sense that includes not only the needs of our children, but also the needs of the adults, everyone in Enfield. And that's your task. You have to take the work that we do, talking about what the needs of our students are, balance that with the needs of every member of this community, and return an appropriation to the board. And when we get that back, we'll work with it. And we're here to work with you as you work through the process and as we work from January 8th to sometime out in May or maybe early June, if it takes that long, we're going to have a lot of talk. We're going to figure it out. We're going to find out what's best. We know what we'd like. We know what we need. The question is balancing that with what we can afford. So if we look at some of our students, we think about their future, and we think about our future, we just wait, and we work, and we continue to work, and we'll determine where we're going to go next. I want to finish with a special appreciation. Special appreciation for the voters of this community who overwhelmingly sent us a message that said, we want a 21st century world-class high school. They came out 2-1 in November and said, build the best high school in the state of Connecticut. We're on our way to doing that. I want to thank our staff. Many of our administrators are here, but they all work very hard putting the budget together. But more importantly than that, they come to work every day battling tremendous challenges. They work with our students. They're highly dedicated. It's a 24/7 job. You know, if you've been an educator, you never leave it behind. You do it all the time. I want to thank my cabinet for their work, and especially to Guy and Tony, because they have been crunching numbers and putting things together pretty much 18 hours a day for the last week. It's been a tremendous effort. They're both running on empty, but I do appreciate their work and everything we did to get this far. And our special friends. We've got some great partners out there. Lego is going to come to us and give us creativity and innovation centers. Mass Mutual has partnered with us on a couple things already. The mayor has put together the Business Education Forum. We continue to meet and explore new ways to bring new resources into our school district. So they're very helpful to us, and we'll utilize their work and their expertise as we move forward. And also to our elected officials, because you are volunteers. You're volunteers who are passionate about your community, who give your time, who usually fight no-win battles. You know you can't please everyone, and yet you come out night after night, day after day, hour after hour, and work through some of these things. And this is not going to be easy. We have a lot of things that we'd like to do for our children and a lot of things we'd like to do for our community, and you have the awesome responsibility of trying to figure out what we can afford to do. So as we look forward, we know that children are the living messages we send to our future. It's a future that we may not see. It's a future that we may not enjoy because we're a little older. But it's a future that we know we have a responsibility to provide for. And the best way to provide for that future is through the children that come to our schools every day. Thank you. So as you can see from the slides, it's been a pretty busy last 6 months, but it's also been pretty exciting. There's lots of really neat things happening out there. So we thank you for your time this evening, and we want you to know that the administration is prepared to work with the board and the town council any way you need. We'll provide any information you need. We'll be available to you anytime you need us to work through and come up with a creative budget for next year. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Schumann. Certainly, you give us an awful lot to consider, and we have a long couple of months ahead of us. I'd like to also thank the council folks and the town manager for coming and seeing the process off at its very beginning. And as Dr. Schumann said, we're more than happy to work with you on any information you need as we work our way through this budget to get to that final number. There are a couple of general questions I'd like to just throw your way. I think the board would like to get a hard copy of this, or read my mind. Would we be able to, I know it's a large document, but can we, if we bring a pen drive in, can we get a copy of it to look at it that way, Guy?
We'll work on getting it a little bit smaller. I'll see what happens if I can scan it.
Great, because I think some of the other folks may want it as well. And is there?
How many pages is it?
Oh. He's got layers and layers in there on the PowerPoint. That's the problem. The other question has to do with a timeline. You spoke here about presenting the details and doing it by goal area. Have you put together a timeline, or can you put together a timeline that everybody can get so that they can hear the details and know the dates and the times that we're going to be doing that?
Yes, I would. Ask you to allow us till next Tuesday night to do that. Next Tuesday, we'll begin with the discussion on the full-day kindergarten, and we'll map out the time commitment we think it'll take to present all that information to you through the goals, and then leave you some time to the board to make some final decisions before you settle on your final appropriation.
Can you publish that on the website so that people know when we're going to talk about a particular area? For instance, if people are interested in all-day kindergarten, they know that next Tuesday night you're going to discuss that. And if they look at some of the other, if they have the notice of the other nights, that would also be helpful.
We will publish it on the website. We'll send it out through our Twitter account, and we'll make sure we mention it every time we're on ETV.
Sounds great. I think, at this point, there's an awful lot here to consider, and I don't know that the board has any kind of general questions they'd want to deal with here until we get the more specific nitty-gritty of the presentations. If anybody does, perhaps we could ask them now. Just general questions about the budget itself. If you want to make a comment as well, that'd be fine. Tina?
I just wanted to say thank you, because it was such a detailed report with your increases and your decreases and what you would like to move forward with and how you took everything into consideration and then narrowed it down. And I think that between everybody working on it, you guys did a really good job on your presentation, and I really appreciate getting a presentation like this, because it's something we can definitely look at and review and educate ourselves on what the needs of the district are. Thank you.
Any others? Okay. Very good. Thank you. We'll move on then. Everybody has their copy? Okay. Then we'll move on to the next item on the agenda, the new business, would be the discussion. Item 10B, discussion related to consolidated high school mascot and school colors. Dr. Schumann.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Another one of your challenges is going to be the beginning of figuring out some of the decisions related to the consolidation of the high school. But some of the ones that we would ask the board to consider relatively soon are important, because as the architect gets selected, some of these things may be necessary for the architect to move forward with the first rendition of the plans. Certainly, there is an emotional impact to consolidating the two high schools. You have two very strong traditions, two high schools that have served the community tremendously well. They've got long histories of successes. And in this consolidation process, we want to make sure that both traditions are moved forward and that nothing is lost. And that will be a challenge, to make sure we do all that. But that is the goal coming out of the box, to make sure that we don't lose any of the strong traditions, because the members of this community have strong ties to where they went to high school and their memories there and their support. And we want to continue their support for our school system by merging those traditions as we consolidate the high schools. So tonight we've asked Mr. Dresick to address some of the issues that we'd like you to tackle first.
regarding the naming of the building and some of the school colors and the mascot, because those are pieces that the architect may wish to incorporate into their designs as they start to work for the community. So I'll turn it over to Mr. Dresick, and he'll share some ideas with you that we'd like to recommend to you, and then, of course, the board can make its own decisions at some point.
Thank you, Dr. Schuman. And as Dr. Schuman mentioned, some of these, the three big sort of outstanding issues that the architect may request of us to put in the design plans for the new building, and at the last Board of Education meeting, there was a discussion to place this on the agenda as a discussion item, but we thought it'd be prudent at this point to bring forth our recommendation as an administration as far as, you know, what we would recommend to the board, and then give the board some time to deliberate. The one thing we would ask that if the board could consider possibly putting a timeline together or a drop dead date on some of these, because as you know, the building committee is in the process of selecting an architect, and we like to have some of this information available for them, you know, if need be. As of right now, through our conversations with Dr. Pongrantz, we thought it might be reasonable at some point by the end of February to maybe have some of these decisions made. So that being said, I'll jump into the three that are listed on the agenda for this evening. And the first question was the name. And I'll state, just because the function of the school has not changed, so technically the name of the school is already Enfield High School. And in order to change the name to something different, the board would need to follow the process that's outlined in Board Policy 9610. And just for the sake of time, I'll read you the provision of that policy that would apply to this. And under Section D of 9610, it says that once named, a school shall not be considered for renaming unless the function of the school changes. At no point throughout this process has the function of this new consolidated high school been up for discussion. So technically, you can't change the name. The name, according to your own board policy, is Enfield High School. With that being said, and as Dr. Schuman mentioned, we spent a lot of time during the first 6 months out in the community and through listen and learn events, and people did have questions regarding what was the name of the building going to be. As far as our recommendation goes, according to board policy, the name of the school would be Enfield High School, and we feel very strongly that the wording of your policy dictates that. But we also would like to add that our recommendation be that the name of the high school be Enfield High School, but the new steam wing would be called the Enrico Fermi Steam Wing. That way we would continue the 40-year tradition of the Enrico Fermi High School by bringing the name to the new building. And as the, as the planning process continues, obviously the sooner the board makes that decision, it'd be a little bit easier working with the architect, but it'd also be easier from our perspective. As you've all have witnessed throughout this process of the referendum, there's a lot of marketing material out there with designs and the photographs of the potential of the building. That's something we'd like to continue. And as we go through that process, you know, there's another building going up on King Street right now. We want to make the members of the Enfield community aware that we have this crown jewel of a high school being built. And the sooner we have a name for it and potentially a color that we can incorporate into those materials that we'd like to get out to the public, that would be the better for us. Which leads us to the next question, which would be the colors. You know, as Dr. Schuman says, as the committee starts and the architects start looking at designing the new facility, they may need to incorporate some of the colors into the planning process. So we would need to have to choose, essentially the board would have to choose new colors for the new high school. What we came across while we were researching this is that we actually discovered that we were faced with this same problem not too long ago. A few years back when we combined our hockey team, the uniforms were designed to incorporate the colors from both Enfield High School and Fermi in an effort to keep the traditions of both schools intact. So what I've brought for you this evening was the actual hockey jerseys that we use for technically called Enfield Fermi. I'll hold them up quickly and pass them around to you guys so you can see them. So what they actually did was combine the colors of Fermi, as you can see, the black and the blue, and the green and the white from Enfield High School. Now, verbally, I know that doesn't sound all that attractive, but looking at it, and the audience can see, it doesn't look that bad. But again, that's not our decision, it's just our recommendation to make to you. So if you'd like us to pass them around and take a closer look, we can certainly do that. But we brought you that so that you can at least get a visual of what the potential of the colors would look for and the reasoning behind our recommendation. And our recommendation would be to continue to use the colors, the black, green, blue, and white, that combine both schools, so we can carry on the tradition and the history of both of the high schools into the new building. So our recommendation would be to incorporate the color scheme that's currently used by the hockey team to really to keep the honor and tradition of the two high schools together. And then the last piece would be the mascot. So in addition to the new colors, we'd also have to endorse a new mascot for the school. And again, as the building committee designs different aspects of the building, the need for identifying a mascot may need to be determined in order for them to incorporate into the plans. For instance, if there's a new gymnasium floor, as you know at the high schools, there's a mascot on the floor. So we would ask that the board consider that in their discussions going forward. As a point of reference as well, now that I have the nice, and they're not being used, so they don't smell like a used hockey jersey. When the hockey teams combined, they were actually known as Enfield Fermi and nothing else. They did not have a mascot. And as recent as this year, the young men on the hockey team decided that they wanted to actually be identified as something. So the team took a vote, and the team decided to name themselves the Enfield Fermi Falcons. So in sort of staying with that tradition, when we also did some research about other districts that have gone through a similar experience that we have, the closest that we can find to Enfield situation was East Hartford High School. Years ago, East Hartford and Penny High School had merged, as you may be aware. And what the Board of Education did at that point was they decided to continue the name of East Hartford High School, but they took the colors and the mascot from Penny High School and incorporated them into East Hartford High School. So the colors of East Hartford High School are now yellow and black, and they're nicknamed the Hornets. The yellow and black Hornets was Penny High School as opposed to East Hartford High School. So staying along that line, using those same principles, in addition to what the kids of the hockey team had decided, and I guess you don't have to look too far for good ideas sometime, our recommendation that we would, you know, continue the use as the Falcon, as the school's mascot, you know, obviously following the implementation what the hockey team had chosen, but also, I think more importantly, it ensures that Fermi's history is not forgotten when they go to the new building. So essentially, we'd be carrying all the colors together and really representing both schools coming together, but still allowing the name of Enrico Fermi in the steam wing and also the mascot of Fermi's Falcon to be continued with the new, with the new school. With all that being said, those are just recommendations that the administration is coming forth to the board for. One thing we would also recommend that if the board decided to endorse these concepts, and that's what they are at this point, our recommendation would be that we charge the students of the Enfield Public Schools to actually come up with the design of the new logo. Just because currently Fermi has a design for a Falcon, it's a good way to incorporate the talents of our students to come up with the design of what the new logo would look like, because essentially it's their school. And that's something that we would obviously engage with the schools in and engage with the board in if that's something that they would recommend doing. But that's really, you know, based on the conversation at the last board meeting to initiate this discussion, that would be our recommendation at this point. Again, ultimately, it's your decision to do it, but we thought it would be prudent to at least provide you with some options at this point.
Just a clarifying question. I know you showed us the hockey shirts. Looking at all the uniforms, they take colors differently. And, you know, like baseball uniforms would be different than the hockey or basketball and stuff like that. How would you propose to deal with those designs?
We're in the process of examining different types of, and you also have to take into consideration not just athletics, but there's band, there's other right. types of uniforms that'd be involved. It's challenging because you have four different colors to deal with. So some of the specs that we have incorporate one color or another. Now, the challenge also for home uniforms, they have to be white. So as you can see, with the exception of football can be an alternate color.
Right.
So really, it's how you incorporate the different patterns into it. We certainly can provide more examples of other sports other than just hockey going forward and some sort of design outlay. We wouldn't have the actual uniforms for you, but we can certainly put together more of a presentation for you at a further date if you were to decide that.
Okay. Board, have any questions? Peter had his hand up, then Tina.
Okay, I'm just trying to figure out what's wrong here because you just hit just about everything that I had written down. So,
great minds think alike, Peter.
I like the idea of keeping it as Enfield High School. I think the only thing that I had different was two things. I was thinking gold and green for the boys' uniforms, blue and black for the girls, but I love that color combination, so scratch that one. I had down keep the Falcon, but add golden feathers or some golden feathers in it. for the green.
Throw that to the kids?
Huh?
Throw that to the kids when they're sketching. But he had suggested having the kids come up with
The design.
The design of the logo.
Eagle.
Of the eagle, yeah.
So I'm thinking with golden for.
Okay. Tina?
Just a couple questions. So if we were to go ahead and, can I just ask what the other, what the picks on the vote were with the hockey team? Do you know what the two choices were, or were there three choices?
My understanding, it was Raiders or Falcons.
Okay. What happens if Fermi ends up being used as a school, like a middle school? So, I mean, at that point, you would still continue, you would have to name it Enrico Fermi. Based on the board policy, or no, because it would be changing its function because it would be like a middle school now?
The function would be changing.
Okay.
So right now, if it's used as another high school down the road, then yes, you would have to name it Enrico Fermi High School. As long as the function of the building is not changing, then, or if it would be changing, then you can name it whatever you'd like.
Okay. And I don't know if you guys discussed this in terms of all this, but since this is being decided, is there any work being done on the fact of talking about consolidation of the sports teams sooner rather than later, or is that a charge that we're going to start to, I guess that would be something we should probably start to consider.
I think that's dictated by the leagues, if we can or can't.
Right.
I think in the past we can't do that because it's two separate high schools.
Yeah. But you did it for the hockey team.
But it's because of a lack of...
The hockey team was based on enrollment.
Mr. Chairman, we do have our athletic director here who may be able to... tell us exactly the logic behind what CIAC does on this.
If Mr. Bernstein, could you come up to the microphone, please, Barry? I didn't see him out there. Thank you.
First of all, good evening and welcome to everybody for listening to everything that we have here. Having Mr. Newton here was also on the CIAC, many of the committees, and the executive board. A couple of things would dictate. So that we know that the hockey is a separate issue. Hockey was not a consolidated team. It was a co-op team under the rules of the CIAC, which states if a certain number of players, and it has for every sport the number of players, you can't have more than 14 in hockey from any school. Both teams fell below last year, 14 players. They had like 10 and 11. So it was allowed to cooperate as a cooperative team, and that was even the addition of the teams that came on. East Granby and Stafford have two players. Because they had no place to go, the CIAC was gracious enough to allow those kids an opportunity to play, yet the whole team still has a total of about 23 kids, which is way below the average. But that's a cooperative team, which is different. In order to merge teams, you could not have two school status. That's a CIAC regulation. If down the road there was a transition period, and I know there's been talk over the time that there could be a two-campus situation for a year or something. That would be something that the CIAC would have to approve if that were going to happen. But merging the teams beforehand, you couldn't do because of numbers. So just to use football as an example, you can't have more than 35 players returning from either school, and you would have more than 35 players if you just looked at last year's roster going forward for Fermi, same thing for Enfield High. And it's that way in all our other sports with the exception of hockey right now.
Okay, I just want to clarify one thing that you may add into this, Tina. In an early version of this, when we were first talking about this, they were talking about consolidating over time. My recollection, please correct me if I'm wrong, we're talking about maintaining both high schools until the other high school opens, if I'm not mistaken, correct?
It's really never been addressed in all of the committee meetings, because I think there were thoughts that what if we could combine the sports teams and try to get some unity going between the two schools. And I know as a parent at sporting events, a lot of people come up to me and say, when are you guys going to combine the sports teams? And that seems to be that seems to be on a lot of parents' minds.
A lot of rumors about that, too. And
exactly.
I know one of the things people had come up with at one point was, well, what, the freshmen all go to one school, let's say, and you keep phasing. The problem with that, besides even if the CIAC would allow that, is you would put the freshmen kind of in limbo. If in two more years they would be all in one school, you would have the freshmen all going to one school, learning the system of that school, and then by the time they're juniors or seniors, they'd have to learn the other system. In the meantime, they would only be eligible to participate as freshmen at the school they're at. They wouldn't be able to play junior varsity or varsity at their home school if it was a crossover school. So there are issues with that if they tried to merge too soon.
Well, I think thankfully that plan is gone.
Which
he's talking about the plan that kind of isolated the freshman
right.
type of, and correct. That plan is completely.
I just wanted to address why that was one of the reasons right. why people right. asked me why.
Yeah,
that
no.
Really
thankfully, with the way the construction can work at Enfield High, they'll be able to. There's enough swing space that everybody's going to stay. So I guess we're just kind of reiterating: you cannot combine the sports teams ahead of time.
No. If there were a low
unless there
numbers,
was a no low enough number and you did a co-op
like swimming
and
is a co-op.
Correct.
Right,
okay, and which we don't see like you're saying in football, even soccer, because there's
soccer,
so many kids that play soccer.
Not even in cross country. Cross okay. country, the numbers are going up, and having the addition of the middle school cross country this year, it's added numbers for both programs next year, which is great.
Okay. Yeah.
Now, I just want to have the right message going out. We've both gotten phone calls from people thinking that we're going to combine sports next year.
Right.
And my understanding and hearing you say it, our intent okay. is unless we come up with a cooperative team because of low numbers, it'll stay that way until we actually open the doors of the renovated Enfield High School.
Right.
Okay. Other questions from the board members?
Not a question.
Okay.
A comment. I think we should also name the art wing. And my own suggestion is the Paul Robeson wing. He, having lived in Enfield and been a world-famous musician and actor.
Arts and the steam wing. Music has its own wing.
Music is a separate wing.
Music's a separate wing, and art is just on one
well,
of the floors.
Well, then it makes
the
even
steam.
More sense for the music wing.
Yeah, we can certainly put that down. Are there other comments or questions about the direction that you're recommending? What I'm hearing you saying is you're asking us to say, do you want to go this way in terms of maintaining the traditions of both, trying to combine the traditions of both schools, combine the colors of both schools, come up with a logo, putting it out to the kids. And I'm guessing you're saying the art department to at least do some sketches. Is that what you're asking us to do?
Yes. I mean, one of the things that we've heard loud and clear in the last 6 months was maintaining the traditions of both buildings. So that was the basis for our recommendation. But again, it's our recommendation to you as a board. We would ask for some direction as far as timing goes in making these decisions, and we think that the end of February would be prudent to do so. But depending on how the board chooses to go, if you endorse these suggestions, then we can start the process earlier. If you require further discussion, then we'd have to place it on further agendas. But we at least wanted to continue the discussion with you this evening.
I think we would need to have at least another meeting of discussion and maybe have you folks bring some other ideas or consolidate some of the ideas you have. But in terms of the question of the time, I'd turn it over to Donna or Tina, who are on the liaisons to the building committee. Which when do you think you would need that answer?
I think ASAP? We're going to need it end of February. Is probably a really good, because the architect will be chosen beginning of February.
Really?
Right now they've been shortlisted and. We're going to be moving. We can't. This is can't dilly dally.
Well, and to add, there's a special legislation that they're hoping.
Right.
And so, if that legislation passes, they'll be able to build the high school sooner, with a possible start date of almost a year earlier.
Well, that's what the contract is written that went out in the RFQ actually
right.
has in the earlier 1 year start date.
I've got Peter. I've got Tom.
Can
and
I
then
ask
I've got,
my question.
Go right ahead. I thought you did.
No, I was answering the question. I just want to comment that I think the art department should take the lead, but I think that all students should be encouraged to put pen to paper and offer us the logo. I think that, you know, there's a lot of things that come out of that. And also, I really want a way that we come up with these ideas, and when we have a manageable number of ideas that we hear from the public.
Sure.
And I'd like to see this chamber full of people come to see us. Thanks. That's all.
Peter, then Tom, then Jen.
Katie.
Katie, I'm sorry.
Okay.
I think it was last year that they came out with the hockey uniforms. And, I don't want to offend anyone, but I feel like I've heard a lot of comments about people not actually liking the colors of the uniforms particularly. And I honestly can't see myself running in a cross-country uniform in four different colors. It just doesn't, it does honor both the schools, but I think I'm, it's just too much. And I don't know, maybe it's more of a student decision, seeing as it's a decision that affects us directly. And not even us per se, but future students to these high schools. I think maybe a vote would be the best way to do this kind of thing for both mascots, colors, and uniforms, both, all three, because it's their legacy. The board legacy is more policies and budgets, but for students, I think their legacy is their colors, their traditions. So maybe not even voting between, like I said, our grades are kind of just going to be gone by the time this is all started. So maybe more towards like the middle school for a vote, and the younger high school grades. The high schools can vote too, but I think it would be really wise to include the middle school in this position, in this decision, because they don't have a high school yet. So they can vote and not be so, you know, torn, because it's going to be down the middle, I'm not sure, but I think Fermi has a little bit of a higher population of students than Enfield High, so that would make it unfair, of course. But for middle schoolers who don't really know, don't really have those ties yet, they could have, you know, a more reliable source of decision making.
That's very interesting.
Yeah.
Tom? Donna stole some of my thunder. I think it's important that we do have the public input on this. Mm-hmm. A suggestion, we're talking about a new era for Enfield and a new school for Enfield. You might want to consider a new color. And then I absolutely reach out to the middle school kids. That's their legacy that they're coming through. And at least have the option of a new color, maybe even a new mascot. It's a new era for Enfield. We're moving into the 21st century with a brand new school.
Jen?
I'm just curious, because you guys are going out for a new architect, are we positively going to have a STEAM wing? Like, is it, and a music wing? It will still look similar to what it is now? I'm just nervous about that. I've had a lot of comments about that. Yeah.
The Board of Ed is really who determines what's going to be in that building, and the building committee needs to abide by what we have set our vision for that high school. And our vision is the STEAM philosophy, and that will be the vision, and that is how it will be.
Okay, I just want to make sure we weren't jumping ahead and naming a wing if there was no wing.
No, Tina and I are there.
Okay.
It's going to happen.
Okay.
Vinny?
I guess I was going to echo Tom's thing about having a public comment on this, but now I'm worried now if, you know, you want to bring in the middle school, how we can get this done before the end of February, do you have something dancing up in your head there that you can get the kids involved here and see if you can get a vote or whatever you, or a consensus?
I'm going to throw out a suggestion that we take one class, and that'll be the prospective class that will be the first graduating class from the Unified High School.
And that would be the eighth graders now.
I mean, it's a suggestion.
They'll be incoming freshmen next year to the two respective schools, and then they're
right. So right now they're all together at the middle school and could do this all together as a. Almost like a project or a graduation project. Or
I'm going to throw out just a couple of comments on this here. I think we certainly need to solicit input from the kids and students, whatever grade levels we ended up doing that with. But I think we have traditions here with lots of families and college students who went there who have some vested interest in this and some very, very strong feelings about that. And so I don't think we can limit it one way. I think what we have to do is solicit input. And I think what we need to do is present some options. And I think in order to get input, high school kids and college kids understand mascots and colors. Middle school kids are not as tuned into that because we haven't pushed that. This is the first time we've had sports in a couple of years. And, you know, I think We need to figure out a way to do that, to an efficient way, because we have a timeline, okay? And we also have a very large budget project to deal with in that same time frame. And so, and I don't think we can let that dominate it. So I guess a suggestion would be you folks meet with the folks and put together some options and bring it back to us. Whether it be a brief agenda on a couple of meetings, and then when we finally get to the point where we're going to get input from the various constituencies, let people know that so they can come to that meeting, and that would be a major topic of discussion for folks.
I'm going to agree with the Fermi representative. I think a lot of the students at Enfield High have the same feeling about the colors. The color scheme just doesn't work altogether. I think the idea of trying to appease everyone, although good an idea, it's going to stir more controversy than it is going to, in fact, appease everyone. The idea of possibly coming up with a new mascot or new school colors, I think that is a possibility. I mean, Enfield's rich in culture, rich in history. We have the carpet mill. We have lots of history with the Civil War, with our gunpowder manufacturing. I think we should look into something with that. I'm sure Dr. Frank Taylor would be more than happy to come out and talk to us about the history of it. And he could possibly have some ideas.
Mr. Bernstein?
The Shakers might get it.
The Shakers.
The Shakers?
Tom's got the Shakers.
A second option, looking at the color schemes, talking to some of the design people was, and this would be especially to the Fermi and Enfield representatives, is white has to be incorporated because the home jerseys, according to the Federation, for almost every sport, have to be white, and the two sports that they aren't, in football and hockey, they have to be white as the visitor. However, we did look at, when I spoke to the designer today.
You better come up to the microphone. They'll be after us so you can hear it.
Again, when I spoke to the designer, what they did do, because white has to be incorporated as a home jersey in every sport except football and hockey, there you use the away jersey color. But with white as it has to be, and you took just the black from Fermi, which 95% of their uniform is, and the green from Enfield, you can also come up with a very nice blend if you remove the Columbia blue, which I know is part of Fermi tradition, but is the hardest color to match also in all the different fabrics and the different manufacturers. So another alternative might be to look at the green, black, and white combination, just the suggestion. And I have some markup jerseys on file that Chris has he can send to you with those.
Okay. Yes. Maybe it's just me and looking at the impact of time on our decision. I know each of the schools, the middle school and both high schools, have the principals have groups of students, representative students, who maybe could sit down with the principals and talk about these things, and possibly with one or both of you gentlemen, and talk about the ideas and the different options that are out there. And maybe the principals could talk to their advisory groups, their parent advisory groups, and if they could do it on some kind of a fast-track basis, and come back with some of the options to us, including possibly some of the design colors and stuff like that. Because I know these companies are willing to do almost anything. Kevin?
You know, as you're saying that, it spurred a thought in my mind, going back to Dr. Schumann's presentation, talking about education for all, and I thank both the representatives for taking the
Absolutely.
Time and their contribution. It's excellent. What I am thinking is when we isolate it to the groups that are generally working and are already engaged in the education process with principals, et cetera, there is a large contingent of the lesser attached students. Maybe we'd make it a random sampling, however many you want to make those numbers, to where they put their name in a hat or whatever in a suggestion box at the school to where they want to be considered for that kind of a thing. But also I would say seeking out some of the people that are not normally involved at the school, because you could find some of that, for lack of a better term, patriotism towards their school from the ones that are disengaged currently and gain engagement from them and their peer group. So just an idea that came from your comment.
Peter, and then Katie.
There's a lot of good ideas thrown out here. I just don't want to have to. I feel like you're being rushed. I like the idea of the middle school being involved, and you could probably get some kind of campaign or interaction with the students stuff within 2 or 3 weeks and get something done. You could do the same thing at the two high schools. The ultimate decision is going to lie with the board. And if we happen to get something that coincides, it would be nice and easy to do it. I'm wondering if we're, as far as the colors, we're pushing ourselves too quick. I know, like, with the design of the, or picking a mascot and working that into the design of the school would be very important, and the architects may need that. But I don't know if the architects actually really need the colors yet, the colors that that we would have on the uniforms. Because there are so many combinations, you know, like the black and gold is, you know, like the Steelers, a lot of sports teams have that sharp. You know, I was impressed with that uniform there. But I can see, you know, with the two kids, with what they had to say. So I'm wondering if the architect just needs maybe the mascot first, and then we don't have to rush through with the color yet. We can, you know, be a little more deliberate about that.
Tina?
I just want to say, just because I grew up in Enfield, I'm a former Firmite, so the powder blue is a big thing. I know that. I graduated in powder blue with Jen. But green definitely is the Enfield color. If you play for a sports team in Enfield, you wear green. Enfield soccer, Enfield basketball, Ramblers. So it is kind of a staple in the town to maintain the green. Although, like I said, I wore powder blue proudly.
Katie.
How hard would it be, I mean, I know there's a lot of numbers, but to pass out, like, ballots during homerooms for the nominations of, like, colors and mascots?
I think the issue would be, what would you be asking them, okay, because the ideas are not on the table. I think as much as it would be great to have everybody involved, we have a tight time frame, and we need to, in my opinion, they're just throwing out there, we get a subset of those, of each of those schools, and I don't care if the principals pull those groups together, but randomly, however they wanted to do that, and bring us some options, explore the same things that we're talking about here, because if we ask everybody here, we'll have, you know, 11 different color combinations and so on. We need to get some consensus, and maybe they could start doing that. And then once we get the ideas out there, then we can put them out to a wider group and have people come here and talk to us about what they think one or the other. And we could even get some samples of what they would look like and so on. But it's a matter of getting these folks working on that, developing some consensus with a wide range of things.
So once again, I would ask, what is the rush for the color?
Donna, go ahead.
I think it was said earlier that we have that nice, bright, shiny high school, you know, going in the ground right now, and we want to keep stuff out there. And I think that as the architect does their renderings, they're going to incorporate these things. They're going to, as they sell the building, they're going to be, you know, displaying how the mascot's going to appear there, how the colors are going to look in the building. We're going to kind of be starting to embrace and, you know, immerse ourselves into how this looks and how it's going to be.
Kevin?
So, if taking what you say, and I agree with what you're saying and Peter's consideration, why not make it a shorter timeline, employ their help to get the mascot done? I mean, think about it. If you named them the Turtles, you wouldn't want it to be gold. It would probably be better to be green. So there are a lot of considerations that have to do with the actual mascot itself. So maybe we shorten the deadline, say, okay, can you get back to us with a mascot choice? Once we do that, we can now take the next step to the colors and still live within the confines of that time frame they're looking for.
That's a good idea.
You know what
I'm saying.
Gold turtles.
There are turtles out
there. Terrapins, Maryland, right?
That's right. That's right. I think sometimes you're looking at it in terms of both colors. As I know, one of the things they were talking about doing was putting the mascot into the gym floor with the color things around it, things like that. So, I looking at it both ways, I think taking it, you know, in context with both the design and the mascot and the colors. At least it put the options out there for something for us to look at, okay? And I think, you know, it would involve the kids at three levels, okay? And however the principals wanted to work together to do that, I'd say be consistent the way you did it, the three of you. But I think that would get us some input from a wide range of people. I think Kevin's right. Make it a very differentiated group, okay? That and not just the kids that are currently on those committees or any one group of kids, but allow kids to sign on, so to speak, and then come back to us in a couple of weeks and tell us what you've got, and that could give us some more direction. It may not be as hard as we're thinking, and they may come up with some things that we agree with very, very, very quickly. We see it. But I think let's throw it out to them and have them come back to us in, say, a couple of meetings. If you have folks comfortable with that? And thank the two of you. We need that input. It's funny how all the adults like those colors and our students didn't. I think that's there's a statement there somewhere.
Well, I think it's the emperor's new clothes.
Okay. At this point, I think we've given you enough direction on that. So we'll move on to 10C, action, if any, regarding additional science graduation requirement. Dr. Schumann.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have our Chief Academic Officer, Ms. McKernan, with us tonight. I know she's worked with the Curriculum Committee on this, but we'll ask her to come forward and talk a little bit about their work in terms of the new proposal for a consideration of a science requirement in the graduation at Enfield High Schools.
Good evening, everyone. Nice to see you. We have before you a proposal that was worked on at the subcommittee. Which would change a policy for us to add the science graduation requirement. The subcommittee worked with the department chairs at both high schools, consulted the policy as it is written in regards to literacy and numeracy, and has put forth a policy for your consideration and first reading, where students would have to demonstrate a competency in science for graduation purposes. This policy would be effective with the present freshman class. I believe it's the class of 2016.
This came out of the Curriculum Committee, I assume, correct?
Yes, it did.
Okay. I just need to find it here.
Keep going. It's down.
Mr. Chair, may I make some comments?
Sure, absolutely.
The students at the two high schools have been being tested annually in science, but that's all, and they get their results. It does seem as though more emphasis should be placed on that subject.
That's a graduation.
And this is one way to do it, by adding the science requirement in addition to the literacy and numeracy that's already there. And it is something that we're moving forward with rather rapidly in terms of STEAM. It provides an emphasis on the need to not only learn, but utilize the science that they're studying.
In effect, if I'm reading this correctly, you're just adding on the science performance standard onto it, onto the policy that already includes the math, the numeracy, and the literacy performance standards. So you're doing all that work you started on this summer, and you're putting it together and filling out the policy.
Right. Yes, exactly. We, as Mrs. Hall pointed out, students are assessed in literacy and numeracy, in writing, and in science. The current policy refers to a demonstration of a certain level of performance in only literacy and numeracy. But with the STEAM wing, with the emphasis on science, and with the fact that we believe it is important, whether it is being emphasized nationally or not, we felt that it would be wise to consider a graduation standard there. We also received some feedback from the science department chairs at both schools who stated that they feel that that science knowledge base is somewhat diminished by not having the graduation standard. That was reported by both department chairs, that the students may not view it as at the same level because it doesn't have that requirement. And certainly that's not the message we want to send out.
So,
Peter?
At the moment, as far as state testing, there's nothing that the state is requiring us to do for science.
We take the science test in grade 10 as part of the CAP test, but it is not the it is not written in our policy as a graduation requirement.
Okay. And as far as the policy itself is concerned, what are these proposed changes that you're recommending? Because I don't see it here.
Do you have it right there? Line 78.
I don't have all that stuff.
Red, Peter.
Perhaps while you're looking at that, Peter, go ahead.
Go ahead,
Kevin.
Forgive me. I'm just old school. I thought the standard for passing grade was not failing the class, which I know has changed over time. Now we have the numeracy and the literacy components to it. I think it's very important that we have proficiency in all of the academics, including science. And I don't want you to think for a second I'm diminishing that value. Sorry. However, as we continue to compartmentalize the education requirements into these test scores, I reiterate my concerns that we are teaching children, sort of in Pavlov's theory, to perform toward a test, perform toward a task, as opposed to making learning a process as a program. I would really like further time to discuss this before I would want to act on it, but at the same time, I want to put my concerns out there. Because, as I said, I believe that all of the curriculums that we employ in the schools are very important. Otherwise, they shouldn't be there. So eventually, are we going to say, okay, there's going to be this whole litany of performance statics that you're going to use to evaluate whether somebody is capable of learning the curriculum? I want them to teach into a process of learning.
In response to that, Mr. Feely, presently in our graduation requirements, Enfield requires only two credits in science for graduation. That is another area we should look at very closely over the next year or longer. The state of Connecticut is recommending increased number of graduation credits in the area of science. I think it's overlooked in general, both as the number of courses required to graduate, the type of courses, as well as in this area where it is not a graduation requirement.
Then to increase how many courses you should take rather than a proficiency in the testing itself.
So perhaps both. I understand what you're saying, and that's why I responded in that way, is that I think that presently in the district we need to look at the number of credits that are required for graduation here. And that will be something we should begin to do. And a perfect time will be as these high schools come together and we look at the graduation requirements there, as well as what standard the students need to perform at to demonstrate an understanding of that subject. So I think it's twofold.
Okay. Tom, then Joyce and Jen, did you have your hand up? Okay, it should be Jen and then Joyce, excuse me.
So the policy changes this is a self-imposed thing. This isn't coming from a mandate from the state.
I would tell you that although I don't have data in front of me, a number of districts, many districts do have science graduation.
Okay, so that's the first question. Second, could you classify this as a preemptive towards increased curriculum standards on the STEAM level in anticipation of future state mandate?
The future state mandate in the area of additional science requirements will definitely, we've seen now in the Connecticut's plan for secondary school reform. So there is a greater emphasis on science, but not just taking the courses, but demonstrating a certain level of proficiency as well.
Will this increase the value of our diplomas?
I don't know if it's, I think that we would demonstrate that our students have not only taken our courses and received some type of passing grade, but that they have demonstrated a certain level of competence as well.
And in the event that there is a failure compared in an individual student, is there a plan for remediation? Because that's something that you need to consider as well.
Absolutely. Presently, there's procedures for several ways to meet this standard, and students would be taking the CAP test in 10th grade, and a certain score on that particular test would demonstrate that science requirement. If they were unsuccessful in 10th grade, they'd have the opportunity to retake in 11th grade and demonstrate once again. And if for some reason they still were struggling, there were a variety of options in 11th grade and beyond, including a district performance test, which could be given to them more than one time in their senior year.
Well, thank you.
I can't remember. Can you remind me? Is it for this year, for the 10th graders this year?
No, we were talking about the 9th graders this year.
Okay.
So when they graduate.
That's so it wouldn't affect any of our children this year?
No, we thought with the late edition of this that the CAP test is going to be given in just 2 months, that we would look at this for the 9th graders who have, you know, the vast majority of their high school career still ahead of them to gain their science knowledge and to demonstrate their proficiency in this area.
And I do recall what she just did say is that the the science chairs, when they did come in, said many of the other districts do it. So in my opinion, it would make the value of our diploma more, because we're obviously, if all these districts need this and we don't, it makes it not look as, you know, significant. And also, you know, since I've been on the board, I've always been looking at the secondary school reform, knowing that, you know, when my kids get up, and right now they only need two science classes. They will need three. Won't they also in certain subjects be having mandatory tests? Algebra supposed yes. to? They will have to pass a test.
The secondary school reform has been somewhat stalled right
okay.
now. So not everything has been delineated exactly.
Okay.
There will continue to be at the science test in 10th grade, which is the CAP test. Even when the CAP test switches over to the Smarter Balanced Assessment in 2015, we will maintain a science requirement.
Okay. And then, like, on teaching to the test that I know you're worried about, Kevin, that there is, I think the fourth thing is a performance task, so it's not just taking the test. If they cannot complete the test, they will have another alternative. And that's what they haven't developed it yet either, so that's why we need a little
more
time.
But even the present science, CAP science test, if you take a good look at that test, one of the things that I think you'd be encouraged by, it's not just a content-based test where you need to just remember, let's say, properties of chemistry or electromagnetism or life science. 50% of that test is a science inquiry test to assess whether children know, whether children are adept at the process, the scientific process, no matter what the content is. And that is a skill that we want to develop in students and make ensure that they have the ability to look at information with that, through that lens, in a way where they can inquire properly into the process. Presently, that test is a 50% content and 50% scientific inquiry, and I think it's very valuable, even for our non-science-based students, to have that mindset. And that's why I think the test is not so much teaching to a content test as much as it is teaching to a mindset, a skill set.
Okay, I have Joyce, then Peter, and then I have Donna.
The performance standards that you see here in this policy are the direct result of the state mandating that we utilize the CAPT in some way toward graduation.
Mm-hmm.
And when this particular policy was established, there was a strong feeling that it should not directly be the result of the test, mm-hmm. but rather that they would have several ways, which are all delineated here, in achieving that same standard that the state, that the test itself requires. Now, by adding science to that, we're giving them the test. Let's get some value, acknowledged value, of what they're gaining, not just because they're taking a test, but because it reflects, as Ms. McKiernan has just indicated, a knowledge of the scientific method and what it requires. So we're just filling out the performance standards And initially, the science test wasn't a big deal, but it has grown each year in terms of the CAPT.
Yes.
So that adding it here makes sense. But I do have a concern about the form of the policy, because I think there needs to be some specifics said in the policy as to when it goes into effect, which it does not at the moment. It is part of the discussion and the preliminary information that it would be in 2016. So I think it needs to be in the opening paragraph, where it says, in the future, additional performance standards may be considered beginning in 2016, or the class of 2016. Just add that sentence at the beginning to incorporate that so the policy is complete.
Kathy, will you note that, please? Thank you.
I'm looking around this room, and we're filled with a bunch of educated people. There's just about everybody, I would assume, in here graduated from college. We have two credits that are needed to graduate from high school right now. One thing that that concerns me to no end is this push to get everybody going on the road to going to college. And in doing so, I think we are totally neglecting the vocational areas. College isn't for everybody. There are kids who can benefit by a better automotive program, a better shop class, better electrical, better woodworking. Kids that don't care about taking a third science class. And I think before we push ourselves too far on the academic side, we have to start addressing and looking at the kids who aren't going to go to college, who don't want to go to college, who want to learn a skill and then get out of high school and go get a job.
Actually, Peter, I agree with you, but I do believe automotives is a science in that high school. It fulfills that. Do you, kind of in the back of your mind, know how well do our students do on the CAPT science?
I've studied those numbers several times. I'm sorry I don't have them with me at this point. At the goal level, I believe we're hovering around 40% of the students at the goal level. And at the, I can't recall offhand, I know it's under 80 for the proficient level. But I could bring that to you for our next
meeting. But we're not looking at that our students are performing poorly in science, that they are performing well in science. And
well, I think that I think there's room for growth.
There's room for growth always.
There's definitely a significant room for growth in this area. And I think that Mr. Janitis's point is very well taken. But I believe that there is skills and knowledge that would support children who are going into career readiness as well in the sciences. The sciences have application to all of our lives, college life, everyday living, career, and I believe that by strengthening our science program will help children no matter where their path takes them. The scientific mindedness that we will hope to develop, and the inquiry process that we'll hope to develop, I think will help children no matter where life takes them.
Tina?
Actually, Ms. McKiernan said what I was going to say is that with science, you're learning about science. With English, you're learning about English. With history, you're learning about history. But at the same time, you're learning how to problem solve. You're learning strategies to learn. So it's just, to me, by enhancing a science program, you might hit those vocational kids more so than you might in another type of subject. So I think it does cover a broad spectrum for students, just college-bound.
I would also just add a simple story that I recall from working with some people in industry last year, and they talk about the type of people they look to hire today, especially in manufacturing, especially what used to be, I'm trying to think of the term, machinists. They described it to me like this. They said, years ago, we used to hire people for whom machinists who were very strong, and almost, if you think of them, we hired them from their shoulders down. Now we're really hiring people to run these advanced machinery. They need to have a higher level of understanding of many subjects, including computers, technology, science. And they tell me that there are very good jobs in the state of Connecticut that can be had at good wages for children, for students who are well-rounded and who are very strong students who may not have a college education. And I believe all of our students need to be college or career ready. I believe this is one requirement that will emphasize science more strongly than it's been emphasized. In listening to department chairs, they feel it has not been valued as much as it should be. Certainly your highly achieving students who know they're going to college will probably take 3 or 4 years of science. That is just the expectation of anyone going to college. But for our students who may be not as high achieving, this may emphasize science to the degree it needs to be. I believe it will serve them in many aspects of their future life.
Mrs. Sherrod, and then Kevin Feely.
As a person with a extensive science background and as a skilled tradesman and an employer of skilled tradesmen, I can tell you this is a twofer. You're focusing on your education side of it for those with college, and the scientific method alone teaches you analytical skills, and it allows you to problem solve on the ground, and the ability to do that, that's something that I look for when I hire even unskilled labor. So it fits in with everybody's agenda, I believe.
Kevin?
This conversation is exactly what I got involved in the Board of Ed for. It's to hash out issues like this. I value the debate on all sides of it. I would encourage the board not to take action so we can discuss it further, because I think that as a framework, I agree with the principles behind it. I would like to know more. And it's just my request to the board that we put it to the table for a bit so we can discuss it at a later time.
Well, I think I was just going to clarify that.
You're absolutely right. It's the first reading.
This is the first reading. The idea here would be to have a motion to accept it as the first reading. I think we'd like to have you come back and discuss it some more. I agree with Kevin. This is the kind of discussion we want to have. It brings out the ideas that we need to have aired. At the same time, I'd make the recommendation, I think that Joyce made, about adding one line on line 13 just to add in 2016, beginning Certainly. With the class for science for 2016, just to clarify that issue. Yes.
Clarity, Mr. Chairman. When it's indicated in the agenda, action, if any, required is why I addressed it from that point.
Right.
So, okay.
Peter?
A comment that Donna made when you said automotive is considered a science. Now, see, I didn't know it was considered a science. And what I would like to know is what else in the voc ed area is considered sciences? And if there are things, because, I mean, if you're going to be a carpenter, you're going to have to think. I don't care what you call it, scientifically thinking, but, I mean, you are planning ahead. So all those areas. So I would like to see, before we pass on anything, is what in the science program would be considered to be part of the voc ed program? Because I don't want a kid sitting in earth science or biology or something like that who has no interest in being there and failing and having to go back and take that class again at the expense of not being able to take, say, his automotive class, because that's why he's probably in school. A lot of these kids are in school because of those kind of classes. That's why they go, and that's the only reason they show up. A lot of kids come to school to play sports, and that's it. That's the only thing that gets them into school. And I don't want to be driving kids away by getting these standards to be too high unless I know that you can take some of these other classes and they fall in the category of this of a scientific elective.
I can bring that information from the program of studies. I'll also share with you the secondary school reform and their comments in the area of science.
That'd be great. I'd entertain a motion that we accept this as a first reading, which allows us to continue discussing it, because we have to do a second reading at the next meeting.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Feely. Is there a second? Seconded by Donna. Any discussion on that?
What do you mean we have to pass the first reading in order to continue to discuss it?
Well, if we don't have it that way, then the discussion would end. The first reading allowed it, technically, after she gave her presentation here, we should have made a motion just to accept this as the first reading of that policy, with the idea that we would, once we had the vote on that, we would have a discussion.
Well, there's nothing to preclude that we can't discuss this at a later, at the next meeting or the meeting after.
No, we're
going to. It wouldn't show on the agenda.
Well, you put it on the agenda then. No, I mean, just put it on the agenda.
But the process the process is built in to allow us to have continued discussion and not to make that decision in one meeting. It just facilitates discussion. It's just that.
What I don't want to do is if we do the first reading and then come back at the next meeting and say we'll have the second reading and vote on it if necessary, without having the information that Ann says she'll get that I can sit down and look at.
Our intent is to have her come. That was the first thing I did, was invite her to come back to do that. And I think. And if we're not ready to do it at that point, we could send it back to for further rewrites or additions, deletions, or what have you. But the first reading just allows us. It was presented here. It was put together by the curriculum committee, I believe, and allows us to continue that discussion. There's no interest at all in shutting this discussion down.
Mr.
It's just
Chair,
process. Yes.
I believe that. Some of the confusion may be because of the two items that are listed relative to this. We have C, action if any, regarding the additional science graduation requirement, and then the next item is the first reading of a policy. So that led to some confusion here.
Tom, I think you're correct, Joyce.
Yeah. We always have the option between the first and second reading to table if we're not getting the proper answers.
Sure.
I mean, we can pass the first reading, move it along. If we don't get the response that we're looking for, we feel that we need further discussion, we always have the option to table when we go to approve for the second reading. So, I mean, there's plenty of options on the table, and I don't think this is hindering us or limiting us in any way.
I would agree. So basically, the C and D should be combined, correct?
Yeah.
But it should be one item.
Yes, it should be.
Either way,
absolutely.
Go ahead. There is a motion on the table that was seconded. I think we, at this point,
I'm just asking if there's any further discussion on this.
Gotcha.
Is there any? At this point?
Yes.
Peter.
So we will be able to, if we pass the first reading, we can still talk about this without pushing it through.
Correct.
With any additional science or related,
yes.
The way Joyce had worded it. Okay.
And Tom is correct. If at the next meeting we don't feel comfortable with it, if we think it needs further work or further discussion, we can table it and bring it back, send it back to the curriculum committee and have them bring it back to us. It's just a process to get us through that. Any other discussion? Roll call, please, Kathy.
Ms. Hall?
Yes.
Mrs. Rancourt?
Yes.
Mr. Janitis?
Yes.
Mrs. LeBlanc?
Yes.
Mr. Feely?
Yes.
Mr. Grady?
Yes.
Mrs. Suzak?
Yes.
Mr. Sirard?
Yes.
Chairman Neville?
Yes.
Motion for the first reading passes.
Okay. And we'd just like to invite Ann to come back at our next meeting, and we appreciate this discussion.
Thank
you very much. Item 11, board committee reports. Do we have any committees reporting here?
Yeah.
I was just going to comment on the building committee.
Absolutely.
They met this last Thursday, and they formed a subcommittee to go over the list of architects, and they were going to shortlist on Saturday and get back to the board on Thursday night. So they're moving right along. Yep.
Good.
And then they're going to do a presentation. They're going to have the architects present, I believe, on Saturday, February 2nd.
To the committee or to a wider audience?
To the committee, but anybody, I mean, the committee meetings are open because they were going to do it in the evening, but they're with the list of, you know, if they come down to four or five architects, they felt that that would be a very long night. So they felt that they would be fresh if they could do it like from 9 to 2 on a Saturday.
That's great.
So,
Donna, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, actually, I did attend the evaluation program and the shortlisting. And there were four architects shortlisted. I don't know if it's gone out to the committee yet. I don't think so. And they'll be voting on that this Thursday night. You know, they did, they were there almost 3 hours on Saturday morning, and we used the state QBS evaluation of looking at partnerships and like work processes, and it was quite interesting. I learned a lot, and I think everybody there at the table learned a lot, and I think they did an excellent job shortlisting.
Any other committee reports? As Dr. Schuman had detailed earlier in his comments, the Joint Security Committee met, and Vinny and Kevin and myself are on that. We met last week, and we're meeting tomorrow morning, I believe, at 9 o'clock over at the boardroom. The meetings themselves basically take place mostly in executive session. And so it's not something that we produce minutes for that are published for some of the obvious reasons. I would be happy to, and I'm sure my fellow members would, at an executive session with the board, we could give them a little more detail as to some of the discussion that we've had. Dr. Schuman also talked about going to the meeting. Chris Drezik went, and so did I, down to the AquaTurf for a full-day session, and it was very, very worthwhile. I sent out a copy of the PowerPoint. It was 60 pages, and it was actually quite thorough. And I, also all the links, which are hundreds and hundreds of pages, mostly federal documents. That was well presented, I think, we'd be happy to talk to you about that at a later date or an executive session. I will send it out to the whole board as well. I just got it and today, and I will get the link out to tomorrow morning. Okay. Any other committees? There being none, let's move on to board member comments. And why don't we start at my left with our Enfield High representative.
As stated earlier on during our invocation, Aileen Furon, a member of Enfield High, passed away this weekend. What Aileen did for our school was unite us. She was remembered in her memory, but commemorated in her life. She united us as one school. We had a little saying, which was "Go Green" for Aileen, and I'm wearing green today in her memory. We united, and we raised funds for her and her family. We united in her passing, and we have a banner that we're signing for her at Enfield High. All of Enfield High is saddened by her loss, and we would like to extend our sincerest thoughts to her family at this time. On a much lighter note, the Buzz Robotics team has started its season this Saturday. And I would like to invite all the board members to come by and visit our team during the season. We meet every single night, so feel free to come by. We put in a lot of hard work throughout the season. We meet every single night and for hours on end. And it would be nice for our team to get some recognition from the board. Unlike a lot of the other clubs in school, it's a more hidden program. And it needs to be in the light. It connects a lot of what we learn in school, and it lets us do it in a hands-on setting. I can take what I learned in physics class, and I can go out as a member of the team, I'm a member of the team, by the way, and apply what I've learned in a practical setting, and I can see when I'm gonna actually use the stuff that I'm using in class in real life. So I think it would be a great idea for you guys to come by. I can personally give you a tour of our manufacturing operations and let you see. Thank you.
Very good. Jen?
I'm the representative at Eli Whitney, where my two boys go. And tonight we're missing PTO because we're here. But next Wednesday they'll have McEducator Night, which is at McDonald's on Hazard Avenue, like in front of, is that ShopRite now? Yeah. It's from like 4 to 7 on Wednesday, next Wednesday. So Tino and I will be there feeding our children McDonald's, which they probably get enough of anyways. And then I just wanted to say, I've, since last month, I've I go in every Wednesday to help out at Eli Whitney with my the two teachers, and I just want to say I feel incredibly safe at Eli Whitney. I think Mrs. Ingalls has done a wonderful job. She's, you know, has always stopped me on occasion, asked me, you know, my opinion and everything, and I really commend her on that. And, you know, to the parents, because I had to explain to my husband how when you get there, you need to say your name, who you're there for, and you need to leave your ID, which is something new that we haven't really had to do in the past. So, you know, just understand that, you know, like the Secretary Kathy, she's got a lot of things going on, but it's very important that you go in, you sign in, even if you're there and they recognize you, they know you, it's very important to leave your ID when you're going around the school for any events or any meetings or anything. And then something else that I'd like to suggest to Dr. Schumann and the cabinet is it's a little too late now because the kids are going back to school. But I know that I had a lot of parents and a lot of college students comment, and I wish you were able to meet with them during the winter break, but maybe when they come back in May, you could meet with some of the new freshmen. And just ask them, because a lot of them did say they weren't as prepared for college as they thought they should be. Like, they didn't have enough homework. I mean, these are kids that probably had taken high-level classes in order to get into some of these colleges. I know one parent told me his son went to Enfield High. I mean, his son went to UConn and was, like, stunned at how much work he had to do, and that he was sort of questioning how prepared he was going through the high school system here. So I'd really like to see if you could have maybe the principals find you some, you know, recent freshmen, or even, you know, I could probably find some, or Vinny, that we probably know, that just to discuss with them what they feel we could do better to prepare our students. Okay? Thank you.
Very good. Joyce?
Well, I've only been back in the state for a couple of hours. I arrived back a little after 6. But I want to thank New England for living up to its title. I came back to snow. When I went to Georgia, I was being accused of bringing cold weather because they were having 40-degree temperatures. And it was close to 50-something today when I left there and came back to 40 and snow. So thank you, New England.
Tom?
I want to say that it's good to be back. I want to thank everyone. I want to thank the town council for their unanimous support. I want to thank all of the kind comments that came from all of my colleagues on the Board of Ed. And I look forward to working with all of you and accomplishing what's best for the town and for the school system. And to mimic Mr. Janitis, roll tide.
Donna?
Yes, I do. I heard that.
Actually, I'd just like to wish everybody Happy New Year. I have not been to many new occasions. I've been enjoying the holidays, and I hope everybody else has enjoyed the holidays with their family.
Vinny?
I'm good.
Kevin?
A couple things. First, also, from the Joint Security Committee, I just want to assure everybody who's not a part of it and who's out in the public that everybody in there is diligently working for the safety of our schools and your children. And that matters to me as a parent, not only a board member, but it's a diligent process, and I know it's going to be that the people there understand the gravity of it. Also, Tom, welcome back. I definitely look forward to working with you. And also, I just want to, I really am impressed by our student representatives, and I want to say that again. And I am sure that our Enfield representative probably met that science threshold already. But good luck to you in the Buzz Robotics. I know it's a big program, and it's one that's important to the schools and the community. So thank you, and as well to you. I'll tell you what, it takes guts to sit up here like you guys do and make your comments, and especially when everybody's here nodding their heads and saying, yeah, this is a great-looking color, and you step up and you say, no, I don't like it. You know, that takes courage, and that's really what we're trying to develop in our kids. You know, so I thank you very much, and you epitomize what we're trying to do, and I appreciate that.
Tina?
I have all my stuff written down, and one of them was to welcome Tom to the Board of Ed. I was dealing with him prior to me being on the Board of Ed, so we've had some communication, and I'm happy to have them, so we can we can hit the ground running, and with all the budget coming up and the retreat and everything we're doing. Also, I'm the liaison to JFK, but I missed the meeting because I was going to the building committee meeting, but I do know that JFK had their geography bee yesterday, which my daughter thought was really cool. Also, I have to mention this. The Lady Patriots basketball team is doing a great job. They did fall short. They lost one game, but they're coming on strong. And then the Patriots, the boys basketball team, they're picking it back up, and they've won the last three games. So the games are fun. The cheerleaders are there. There's a lot of kids that stay after. It's great to see. So that's it.
Very good. Peter?
At the last board meeting when the police and everything were up here, I wanted to say something, but you turned your head, and I didn't get a chance to get it for a comment, so I'd like to comment on it tonight. I don't know if there's any real way to describe the horrors that took place in Newtown. My heart goes out to everybody that's been touched by this horrific event. However, we now have our public officials discussing what we can do to make our schools safer and to assure the public that our schools are going to be as safe as they possibly can. I honestly believe that we cannot allow the tragedy that took place in Newtown to cause us here in Enfield or the communities around the country, though, to go into a panic mentality. Some stark realities are there are evil people in the world. There are people who are mentally imbalanced. There are amongst us people who we think are perfectly normal, who at any given moment, for any given reason, can snap and do the unthinkable. I would say that short of allowing some trained, certified people in our schools to carry concealed weapons, or at least have access to a weapon, there's not a whole heck of a lot that we can do. There are things that we can do to make us feel safer and some small things, but if there's somebody who wants to commit a heinous crime out there, they're going to do it in one way or another. And they're going to pick when and where they do it. It could be where the kids are getting on and off a school bus. It could be at an athletic event, at a mall, a church, a movie theater, an amusement park, a picnic, or for that matter, wherever people gather in large numbers. I was at the middle school Sunday. There were 70 kids running around in the gym. I didn't see cops or armed guards or anything there. I mean, it's just kids and people are everywhere. Now, as far as our schools are concerned, it's hard for me to believe that in a town our size, with a cruiser in every district, that a police officer can't be at a school within 2 minutes. And then the officer's training kicks in. I think one of the things that we have to, that the police have to be very vigilant of is that they're roaming in such a way that they're constantly ready to go to those schools. At our three secondary schools, there's already a police presence there for a multitude of safety reasons. In all the schools, all the doors are locked within a reasonable time once the kids are in the building. Lockdown procedures have been planned for and practiced, and I think just like we do fire drills, we may have to practice those kind of procedures and drills a little more often. Now for this last set of comments, please listen closely, parents. To a parent, there is nothing more important to you than your children. A parent will gladly give their life so that your children can live. You're their greatest source of defense when they're with you. That's love. Now, for 180 days a year, your kids are in school. And in those schools, whether you know it or not, there are a lot of people who love your kids. It's been my experience in 38 years of teaching that just about everyone working in a school is there because they like being around kids. And in a crisis situation, they're going to be there for your kids. However, I must tell you, when your kids are in school, there is no one more interested in protecting your kids than their teachers. They'll keep your kids calm whenever possible. They'll put your kids in a place of safety. They'll keep your kids out of harm's way. They'll lay on top of your kids to protect them.
and there are many teachers who would take a bullet for your kid. Teaching is a labor of love, and your child's best and final line of defense when they're in school is his or her teacher. We can't stop all the crazies in the world. We can't turn our schools into prisons and fortresses. After 9/11, we had to learn with the threat of terrorism. We make our schools as safe as we can, we do the best we can, and life goes on. Thanks.
Katie?
In line with what was just said, I'd also like to thank the Enfield Police Department for their increased presence at Fermi. I know the students appreciate the extra work that's been put in, and especially I'm sure their families appreciate it too. The week after that tragedy was kind of hectic. I mean, there were rumors about, you know, threats going around, violence, and you could just stand outside the locker room after gym and see parents rushing into the lobby to drag their kids out of school. It was kind of scary almost. It's like, you say it's not right to panic, but there is panic, and it kind of makes you wonder, like, what's true or what's not. So with the presence of the police officers, it was a nice reminder that we are indeed as safe as we possibly can be. And especially when it came down to the pep rally, you know, ultimate threat there. You have a ton of kids in one gymnasium. I mean, the attendance that pep rally was very low. Of course, it was really fun, but it was just, you could tell that people were worried. So when we have the police chief there, it was once again just a nice reminder that we're actually, you know, taken care of and looked after. I'd like to, is he still here? I'd like to thank Mr. Newton for his message to the students. Through the middle of the week or so, he made a message over the announcements, which kind of dispelled the rumors that were going around. It was nice to know that they were being recognized as real threats and not just, you know, rumors between kids. And I'd also like to thank Dr. Schumann for his message over the phone on January 1st, telling the entire, well, I don't know all who got it, but the families of all the students, you know, of the measures that were being taken, because we need to know these things, and it's nice to know that we're being, well, once again, taken care of. So, thank you.
Thank you, Katie. Just a couple of final comments for me. I'd echo the comments about our students. I'm really, really pleased that you spoke up, and, you know, I think Mr. Feely is absolutely correct in saying that you epitomize what we're looking for from our students. And I think the way you've spoken tonight and the way you've done a lot of things, including one of the things that I attended, that it was similar to the pep rally, but it was the Enfield Fermi basketball game on the 21st of December, okay, which I was thrilled to go to. It was packed, and the kids had a great time. There was certainly a security presence there that made us all feel safe. But I think it was the actions of the kids that impressed me the most. They took on that challenge, the racial challenge. And at the halftime show, they presented checks to three of the charities. And I would just like to commend the administrators. They did a great job. The students, and especially the students and the staff, who made this idea of this community act of kindness a reality. It was just amazing that you took that kernel of an idea and made it operational, and you raised, it was over $5,000, I think, wasn't it, Paul? But three charities at the holidays, and I know those charities just were thrilled. I talked to two of them, and they were just thrilled at the actions of Enfield's students. So I'm incredibly proud of you, and it sounds like the board is as well. I think they would echo my comments, the actions that you took, and I'd also commend all of us, all of the staff, and everybody in town for getting us through a very, very tough time. And I think Kevin spoke to it, and I think Vinny and Kevin would echo what a great force we have, both in the fire department, the police department, and all the people who are working together in this committee with us, and the incredible seriousness in which they're taking this project. We think our kids are safe, but to leave no rock unturned so that we can make sure that we're doing the best we possibly can. And I think some things you'll see, some things are just going to be behind the scenes, but I think you'll like what's happening. I think we'll be a better community because of it. That said, it's time to move on to item 13, approval of minutes, of regular meeting minutes for December 11th, 2012. I'd entertain a motion to accept that.
So moved.
Moved second. By Joyce, seconded by Vinny. Any discussion? By a show of hands, all those in favor? Any opposed? Any abstentions? Tom is abstaining because he wasn't here. Thank you.
Was this the last board meeting?
This was the regular meeting of the it was the regular meeting of the 11th. The special meeting was for December 18th, Peter. That's the one the police were here for.
Okay, then I do have something on the minutes.
Which minutes? The 11th?
Wait a minute.
Excuse me.
For the 11th, yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Now you're on the 18th. No, it's the 18th.
Did I go?
Yeah, it's the 18th.
Okay.
Never mind.
Then we voted on that. We need to approve the minutes for the special meeting minutes for December 18th. I'd entertain a motion to that effect.
Motion.
Motion by Tina.
Second.
Seconded by Donna. Any discussion? Peter.
Yes. on page 4, Kathy. You have currently on the guard and access to certain staff members. I meant the National Guard, people in the guard or the Army Reserve, something like that. And then instead of certain staff, certified staff members.
Peter, just as a question, did you mean certified? You mean certified teachers? Is that what you're talking about?
Or certified to have a weapon. Yes.
Okay, just to clarify that.
And then on page 9, I want to make sure it's clear that. I'm sorry. Wait. What's that? On page 9. Where I didn't believe skills would be mastered in 6 weeks. I want to make sure it's not 6 weeks. It's one day a week for 6 weeks. So it's 6 days or six. Sixth one from the bottom. Okay. Thank you.
Anything else? Any other discussion? Sensing none, all those in favor accepting the December 18th minutes as amended, raise your hand. Any opposed? Any abstentions? Two folks that weren't here, so two abstentions. Okay, item 14, approval of accounts and payroll. Tina?
The Finance Committee met on December 18, 2012, to review financial statements for November year-to-date and to examine various documents related to finances. Our review concluded that there is nothing significant to report to the board. I move we accept the superintendent's certification as follows. I hereby certify that in the month of November, total expenditures amount to $10,205,816.89, broken down between payroll totaling $6,113,490.72 and other accounts totaling $4,092,326.17. All payments have been made in accordance with the approved budget and are properly accounted for within the books of accounts. Copies of approval for check invoices are properly documented.
Second.
Seconded by Vinny. Any discussion? All those in, do we have to roll call this?
No.
No show of hands. All those in favor by a show of hands? Any opposed? Any abstentions? Are there any line item transfers?
No.
Okay. Very good. My understanding is there's no correspondence and communications?
We just have CABE, and I believe everybody received the CABE correspondence?
Yes.
And the magazines.
Absolutely.
Motion to adjourn.
Items 16. Let me finish it first.
Oh, finish. Darn it.
Okay.
We
no longer have the need to have an executive session. My understanding is it's been postponed to a later date. Okay. And so at this point.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Seconded by Tom. All those in favor by a show of hands. Any opposed? Never opposed. Have a good night.
Hooray!
Did you miss me?
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. I was heartbroken.